All right, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Are you ready?
Yes.
Who wants to be near the Lord today?
I do.
All right. See, that's awesome, man. I don't know, you guys are ready. So here's what I want to do. You'll see there's a piece of paper on your chair. There are also pins in all of the rows. So if you're in the front row, which nobody's in the front row, but there's a pin probably behind you. So I want to make sure you get a pin, get that piece of paper. I want to do a little exercise to set us up for where we're going to talk about today. We've got a lot of things jammed in here today for what we want to do, but I want to give you just a minute to, in one word, answer this question. God, I'm thankful for fill in the blank. I would like you to think of that as not like thank you for peanut butter, right? That's two words anyway. But think a little bit more, a little bit more. Think of the gravity or the weight of what Jesus has done for you. God, I'm thankful for. And I want you to fill in that word. In a little bit, we're going to give you a chance to come and put those in these baskets that are up here. But I wanted to give you a few minutes to just take some time. And if you don't have a word just yet, maybe during the time where we give God praise and we sing to him, maybe a word will come to you and you can write it down. So I wanted to prep you for that, all right? So let's stand together. We've got some turkey and some stuffing and some all that stuff that's been inside of us for the last couple days. We might need to shake it off a little bit. So let's stand up, stretch it out. It's time to, together as one body, enter in to the presence of the Lord together. This is the only place that all of us get to gather on one given week. We have people here from all kinds of different professions, all kinds of different fields, all kinds of different life circumstances, and none of those matter today because we all get to be here to be with Jesus. So that's a beautiful picture for us today. So let's begin in a moment of prayer and silence, and then we will raise our voices to our God and King. So Jesus, thank you. Remind us today of who you are and what you've done for us. May you strengthen our hearts and speak peace to our souls. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that
away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that'll bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, or a song in itself, if not what you have required.
Full of praise.
you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Good morning. Welcome to church.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dana.
God bless you today. It is a beautiful day. Today is a day of celebration all over the place here.
Yes.
And we want to just recognize God for his faithfulness.
I want to read you guys a scripture this morning. It comes from Psalm 103. Some of you missed the opening part, so we'll redo that here for you. And this kind of explains it a little bit. It says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Look at what he does. "Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases,
yes,
who redeems your life from the pit,
yes,
who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed.
Amen.
Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." So we have a reason to bless God today. We just came off of a weekend of Thanksgiving. And so I put up a question at the beginning, and I said, "God, I'm thankful for fill in the blank." And we said, I want to go a little deeper than, like, "God, thank you for peanut butter," or "thank you for turkey." I want to go a little deeper into maybe some of those things that the psalm says. So you have a piece of paper on your chair. You get a chance to write down one word answer to something you're thankful for. There's a pen maybe behind you or in front of you in those seats. I want to take a minute and have you do that, and we'll give you a chance here during this next song. As you write those words down, I want you to come and I want you to place them in this basket. Just come on forward anytime during the next song or two. And just drop those words in these baskets. And we're going to do something with those a little bit later. But we're going to continue to sing and to give God praise this morning. So go ahead, guys.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of above. Join me, Lord, nature in
10,000 pence. Oh, great. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Good morning. Today is a celebration time. Baptism. Baptism is a symbolic gesture of identifying yourself radically with Jesus Christ. Baptism is a story of the light of God's much bigger story. Baptism is a public declaration that I choose to walk with Jesus, that I'm aligning myself with Him and will follow Him. In Romans 6, 3 and 5, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? You may be seated. We were buried, therefore, with Him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with Him in death like His, we shall certainly be united with Him for resurrection like His. Amen. Baptism is not our salvation. Baptism is our public declaration. It's part of our sanctification. That as we walk forward, we're going to know Jesus and we're going to love Jesus. Here's the great thing. Tamara, I've been so blessed to watch your walk and to watch the massive transformation take place in your life. But there are three parts to this story, who Tamara was, why and how she changed, and where is she in her walk today? So Tamara, I'd like to ask you three questions. You once trusted in and gave your worship and allegiance to what or to who to save you or make you feel good?
I always trusted in God, but I can say I never fully gave Him me. Does that answer the question? Does that answer the question?
Yes. But in the midst of that, then, what did Jesus do?
He held me. He continued to hold me. And He just never let me go.
Now that Jesus has embraced you and holding you, what are you seeing now in your life?
I see a path where I'm not alone.
Amen.
I see a path where I'm a better mother, I'm a better friend, I'm a better person because I trust. I just see a battlefield where I'm ready to enter now.
Thank you. Amen. So, Tamara, we're going to... Anyone in the church who has been baptized, if you could stand with me as a show of unity, and together we're going to read questions to Tamara that she can answer for us. Tamara, in baptism, God calls us out of darkness into His marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and raising to new life with him. I want those who have been baptized to join me, because they're joining you in once again making this public declaration. I ask all of you out there that if you've been baptized, hold your hands out in a symbolic gesture to Tamara as we read the confessions. And if everyone could read along with me as we do these questions. Do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?
I reject them.
Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil?
I renounce them.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbor?
I repent of them.
Do you turn to Christ as Savior?
I turn to Christ.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
I submit to Christ.
Do you come to Christ the way, the truth, and the life?
I come to Christ.
My passage for Tamara was really easy for me. I got to watch you, and again, amazed at the transformation. And my passage for you is Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. All these many people who have had faith in God are around us like a cloud. Let us put everything out of our lives to keep us from doing what we should. Let us keep running in the race that God has planned for us. Let us keep looking to Jesus. Our faith comes from him, and he is the one who makes it perfect. Yes. He did not give up when he had to suffer shame and die on a cross. He knew of the joy that would be his later. Now he is sitting at the right hand of God.
That calls for celebration. What do you think?
Can we stand together and celebrate? The Bible says that when one comes to faith and when one is declares faith to the Lord, all of heaven stops and praises God. All the angels praise him. So I say we join in with the angels and praise him right now. Amen.
My pain.
want to sing. My Redeemer lives. 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 My Redeemer. Sing that if it's true for you. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. Oh, yes, he lives. Amen.
Amen. That's good.
Because he lives, we can lift our eyes to him. When we're going through different difficulties and different things, we don't have to look around to our neighbors all the time, you know. We can lift our eyes to him. He's where our help comes from.
Yes.
My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. Come on, church. Oh, my help is on the way. Surrounds me, chaos about me, but my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. Oh, yes, oh, my help is.
So think about that for a minute. Your God will come through always. Not sometimes, not part of the time, not only on Wednesday, every day, all the time. Hold on to that. So forget not the Lord and his benefits. We're going to dismiss our kids for treasure seekers, and we're going to pray over them. So kids, get ready to go. Let's pray while our kids get ready. So God, we have a lot to be thankful for today, especially thankful for these children, that every generation you give a chance to hear your gospel with fresh ears. So God, empower them to hear you today. Open their ears, open their hearts more and more to who you are. So we send them, we ask you to bless the teachers and the classrooms, that they will hear your truth and be forever changed today. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. I have a special friend who's going to come and talk to us for just a second. This is Dave Jones. He's one of our governing elders. So you guys welcome him.
Thank you. Coming off the Thanksgiving holiday weekend, it's a time where we think about the things we're thankful for. And I'm here to ask you to consider a gift for our pastors. I think back over the years and even this past year and how many times, I would say each one of these pastors has affected me, has come to me, has supported me, and I believe that's true for all of us if we think about it. So I would ask that you would consider that. You can put it in an envelope and mark pastor's gift on it, or I guess go online and do the same thing. So please, think about it in this time that we consider those that have been around us, especially those who shepherd us. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Dave. Yeah, you got two applauses, man. That's good. That's very good. Love it. You guys are a fun crowd this morning. So, all right, so Gavin, we're going to throw up some announcement slides here. So everybody's heard me say this, but I want to keep saying this. So lfachurch.org/what? Info. It's where you can go to sign up for every possible next step that we offer as a church. So this is your best friend. It's always on your phone. It's mobile friendly. Make sure you know that those things are coming up. So a couple things that you need to know are on there is the Parent Summit and the Marriage Retreat have deadlines next Sunday for registration. So make sure that you guys go ahead and, yeah, we're on the wrong slide there. But Celebrate Recovery happens on Tuesday. So you're all right. So if they're not quite right, don't worry about it, because you guys can always go to lfachurch.org/info, and you can find out everything that you're probably not going to retain that I'm telling you right now. So it's all good. So Marriage Retreat and Parent Summit have deadlines next Sunday. Next Sunday, we're also going to have a special time around spiritual and emotional healing for prayer. We want to have a time for that, because holidays, let's be honest, they're wonderful to celebrate, but sometimes they come with some baggage. So maybe this is the year to shed that baggage. So next week, we're going to have a time to pray for healing in those areas, similar to what we did a few weeks ago. You can put your requests in there on the info page as well. And then tomorrow night, we have a discipleship gathering that's going to be happening here at 6:30. There's a focus on that regarding women in discipleship. So everybody's still welcome to come, but especially women. This is an opportunity for you to find out a little bit more about discipleship tailored for you. So we're letting you know that's happening. We postponed that a couple weeks ago to make sure that everybody was able to attend that. So our leaders for that will be there. So it's definitely something you want to be a part of. So 6:30, we'll be in one of these classrooms down here in the building. So have our ushers come. They're going to take our tithes and offerings. So they're going to come and do that, and then we're going to bring up Pastor Greg. He's going to share the teaching with us today. So let me pray for us one more time, and then we'll turn our attention to the Word of God. So Jesus, I asked this morning who wanted to be near to you, and many, many, many people in this room said me. So God, continue to be near to us. Continue to take your Word and bring it to life for us. Let it be like the bread we need for our hungry souls today. So empower Greg to teach and to speak what you have for us. We pray in your name. Amen.
All right, I got a question for you. As the offering goes past, want to put up some images here. And so my question for you is, what do all of these images have in common? What do all of these images have in common? Anybody know? What these have in common is the fact that I know how to have a good time. So these represent what, for me, for about 10 years, the essentials of Thanksgiving. So up here is the game Trivial Pursuit. That was an essential. Also with our game of Trivial Pursuit was the reading of the minutes from the previous year's games, which always, you know, had highlights of winning questions, absurd answers. So there was, you know, very traditional reading of the minutes. There was also a trip to Lancaster that was involved, lime pear mold, which I'm not entirely sure what that is, and some beef jerky. So all of those represented for me some essentials for Thanksgiving. So here's my question for you. What are some of your more quirky essentials of Thanksgiving? And don't give me the super spiritual answer, like the reading of the word and prayer together. Like, what are some of your more quirky essentials for Thanksgiving? What do you got? Pickles and olives? Yeah. Outstanding. A seven-layer salad? I don't even know what that means. I don't think I've ever gotten past the first level, Brian. What else? Football? Yeah, I'm still sore from football on Thanksgiving morning. What's that? The Mummers? Oh, that's New Year's. Sorry. Thanksgiving Day Parade. I was just testing Rich. He passed. Yes. What's that? Morning video games. That's part of your essential Thanksgiving. Is that unique from other days? All right. So we have these essentials of Thanksgiving, where we'd say this is part of what we do. So my question for today is not what makes for an essential Thanksgiving, but my question for today is, why is Thanksgiving essential, right? Why is Thanksgiving, why is that such an important thing for us? And when I say why is Thanksgiving essential, I don't mean the holiday. I don't mean why are, you know, celebrating what happened with the pilgrims and our Thanksgiving traditions. That's not what I'm asking about. I mean, why is Thanksgiving, the act of giving thanks, so essential? The New Testament translates the Greek word Eucharistia. The English Standard Version translates it 51 times in the New Testament. Right, so 51 times that Greek word is translated into thanks or thanksgiving in the New Testament. 14 of those times exist outside of what Paul has written. Right, so that means 37 times in Paul's writings he talks about thanks and thanksgiving. Now, Paul wrote about half of the New Testament, but he hogs about three quarters of the use of the word thanks. And I think the reason Paul does that is because he is convinced that thanksgiving is an essential part of becoming a mature follower of Jesus. So as he wrote letters to churches, he had to emphasize this point of thanks. He had to emphasize this point of gratitude. So Paul is training us in the spiritual discipline. And I use that word intentionally. It's a spiritual discipline. Another way you can say that is that it's a means of grace. It's something that we do, right, to mature, to grow, right, to experience more the grace of God. So Paul is training us in the spiritual discipline of thanksgiving because it's an essential tool that we need in our journey towards maturity. Now, we often view Thanksgiving simply as something that it goes one of two ways. Either it's required for us to be polite, right? It's good manners, be thankful, right? So to avoid the embarrassment of being rude, we insert Thanksgiving. Or we think of Thanksgiving as some emotional response of just overwhelming joy. However, I think what Paul is pointing to in terms of thanksgiving is a spiritual discipline, a pattern where we intentionally position ourselves in gratitude for what God has done. So thanksgiving as a discipline is a means of grace for us to grow and for us to mature. So this morning, what I want to do is I want to look at five ways that thanksgiving in the writings of Paul is essential to our maturity. I think there's five things as you study the way Paul uses the word thanks or thanksgiving that we can learn, that there's five different ways in which thanksgiving is a tool leveraged for us to grow into maturity. All right, so that's what we're going to study. That's what we're going to study this morning. Really going to be all over the writings of Paul. So if you have your Bibles, feel free to follow along. This is a great sermon to take some notes on so that you can look up these passages later on. All of them will be found in the writings of Paul. All right, so first, thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it is a command. Right? So if we are to live in maturity, then we are to be obedient, right? So thanksgiving is commanded. So for us to be mature people, mature followers of Jesus, then we have to obey the commands of God. So here's one of those commands out of 1 Thessalonians. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. It's a command. Not, hey, it's a good idea, why don't you try this out? It's a command. In fact, it's such a strong command. He says, this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you, is that you would be thankful, that you would be thanking God in all circumstances. And up in the top right corner there, you see 1 Timothy, Colossians, two passages in Colossians, two in Thessalonians. These are all commands to be thankful. So it's not an option for Jesus followers to be thankful. If you want to be mature, if you want to live in the will of the Father, then thanksgiving is going to be part of what you do. All right? So we got to make that clear in our minds. And I think the reason Paul repeatedly commands thanksgiving, because thanksgiving is not our natural disposition. We have to work at thanksgiving. We have to work at gratitude. That's why Paul needs to repeatedly command it, right? Like if we didn't have to work at it, he never says, hey, remember to breathe in and out. Remember to drink water when you're thirsty. Like he doesn't have to give those commands, right? But a command of thanksgiving he has to give. Why? Because the tendency of our heart is not towards gratitude. I found this quote by Michael Youssef that I thought was pretty good. Michael Youssef is a pastor down in Atlanta. He said this, God wants to see prayers that are filled with genuine praise and thanksgiving for what he has done in the past. He wants our hearts to be filled with awe and gratitude for his blessings. And this is my favorite part. He wants us to set up memorials in our hearts testifying to the provisions that he has given. He wants us to set up memorials in our hearts that testify to him. And when we give thanks to God, that's what we're doing. We are stamping out for us to remember, this is what the Father's done for me. This is what God is like. Here around church, what are the things that we do to be intentional about this is we use language that is a little bit forced. It's not natural language, but we say things like God sightings. Why do we use language like that? Because we think we need to be intentional about thanksgiving. We need to be intentional about gratitude. That's why we take the time to do public baptisms in obedience, because we want to declare what God is doing in an individual life. That's why we take the time to do baby dedications, because we want to take the time to thank God for the work and miracle of what he's already been doing. All right, so thanksgiving is an act of obedience. So my question for you, as I close my first point, is how do you do it? How are you disciplining yourself for thanksgiving? How are you being obedient? I go through this with my children all the time, right? If they're called to a certain expectation, what's your strategy for doing it? How are you going to get it done? So if God's calling you to obedience, what's your strategy? If he's calling you to thanksgiving, how will you do it? And there's different ways of being thankful. You know, I've seen some that they do a blessings jar, and they actually write things down and put it in the jar, and then they read it at certain times of, this is what God has done for me. Or maybe you have a pattern of prayer times where you are intentional about gratitude. Maybe you're somebody that does the whole thank you notes thing. That's a beautiful way of being intentional. But listen, you need to discipline yourself as a follower of Jesus to grow in thanksgiving. It needs to be part. If you want to grow in maturity, you have to take seriously the call for thanksgiving. All right, thanksgiving is essential. This is number two, to maturity, because it helps us in our battle over the flesh, right? It helps us in our battle over the flesh, and the flesh is that thing that wars against the spirit inside of us, the natural man. Art talked about this a few weeks ago, the spirit versus flesh, that we are in this thing that's corrupted and corruptible, and we have to war against it. So thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it helps us in that battle. Let me show you some passages that do exactly that. So thanksgiving, in Ephesians 5:4, thanksgiving will help you to use your words to give life rather than to promote corruption, right? Thanksgiving will help you speak in such a way that others are built up rather than speaking in a way that leads to corruption. That's useless, that's gossip, that's destructive. Philippians 4:6, thanksgiving will help you in your battle with anxious thoughts. Right, as you're projecting all of these potential outcomes into your future, thanksgiving will root you in the fact that in whatever your projected future is, God is there. He's the one constant. All the rest is fantasy. Ephesians 5:20. Thanksgiving will help you be controlled by the Spirit. That's the context of this verse, is by learning to walk under the influence of the Spirit. And what thanksgiving will do, it will fix your mind on where is God and what is He up to, and will help you walk controlled by the Spirit. And then thanksgiving will also help you walk rooted and established and not taken captive by empty philosophies. I mean, if you just took the time, I'm a little weird, I get that. But if you like listen to any advertising campaign, what is the root philosophy that they're tapping into? Right? Like you buy that, you're now the sexiest man alive. Right? Like what are they appealing to? Right? So don't be taken captive by vain, empty philosophies. And one of the ways that we guard that is we're attentive to truth. We're attentive to where is God at work. Now, I call this a discipline because in my experience, thanksgiving is a discipline because in the moments I need it most are the moments I feel it least, right? Like I don't feel like being thankful. So, a few weeks ago, I talked about, having a chest, right? And living according to this act of volition, this act of the will, not according to your belly based on what you feel or just your mind according to how you think, but there's this exercise of the will. Often thanksgiving is an exercise of the will, and it helps us win our battle over our belly, over our flesh. Have you ever noticed that in an argument that you're having with someone, you can get caught in just spinning around in your own head? Right? And where you think of, oh, if I had said this, or I got this comeback, that'll really get them. Oh, if I had only made this particular point. And it's all this exercise spinning around in your own head. And so as you interact with them, it's not a fruitful interaction because you haven't got outside of yourself. You're only thinking about you, and that leads you down this path of usually of bitterness, of frustration. But gratitude is a discipline that will keep you thinking more holistically about that person. One of the things that a tool that we use around here that I really like is called the Strengths Deployment Inventory, and we're gonna be doing a training on that in I think it's scheduled for February. But anyway, you'll find out more information about it. But one of the things that it talks about is a conflict sequence, right? So you usually have an initial response to conflict, right? And then if the conflict isn't resolved, then it bumps you into the second stage of conflict. At your first stage of conflict, it's a great place to resolve conflict because you're thinking about three things. You're thinking about the problem, right? You're thinking about yourself and how that problem influences you, but you're also thinking about the other person, right? And how the conflict or problem impacts them. When you bump to the second stage of conflict, guess what? You still think about yourself and how the problem impacts you. You still think about the problem, but guess who you're not thinking about? You no longer have any interest in that other person, right? You're no longer thinking about them. The discipline of gratitude in the middle of conflict will allow you to start thinking about, where's this other person? What else do they have going on in their life? What are their particular needs? You know, I'm really thankful for this aspect of their life, right? As you do that work, as you do that discipline. So I often use the discipline of thanksgiving to allow myself to engage in conflict in a healthy way, because it helps me war against the flesh. And maybe you'll find yourself that you engage in conflict in very unhealthy ways, or it could be because you're refusing the discipline of thanksgiving. And if you start to discipline yourself to be grateful, to be thankful for the way God has put somebody else together, the way that they have a different perspective than you, right? Oh, I know that sounds hard, doesn't it? You're like, Greg, I can't do that. Yes, you can. It's a discipline of thanksgiving. All right, third, thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it is the ultimate motivation for obedience. It's the ultimate. It is the best motivation for obedience. Let me give you a couple of passages that clarify this. For it is all for your sake, so that grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. For it is all for your sake, so that grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. What Paul is telling them, he's motivating them with the truth that thanksgiving is going to extend to God if you continue in your current path. Here's another passage where he does the same thing in Corinthians. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is overflowing in many thanksgiving to God. So what Paul is saying is, listen, do this and God is going to be thanked. Do this and people will actually turn in gratitude to God for what you're up to. Now notice the motivation is an increase in thanksgiving, not to you, but to God. The motivation that Paul's tapping into isn't, listen, do this and people are gonna thank you for it. People will see how grand and generous you are and they will praise your name. What Paul is tapping into is saying, listen, if you do this, our Father is gonna be praised. People will actually experience you and glorify God. There will be thanksgiving that increases to God. That's a mature motivation for obedience, where it's not about us receiving, but it's about God receiving. When we get to the point of being excited when another person is praised, we're moving in patterns of maturity. Right? Have you ever experienced this? Like, have you ever been at, I don't know, maybe at like a retirement party or some place where there's a person that is a master of their work that is being honored? Maybe a real lifetime of service, and they've offered themselves sacrificially on behalf of other people. And there's a moment where they are being praised, and you are thinking, this is so right that person is praised. It is so, and you actually get caught up in the joy of praising that person. That's just a little taste of what Paul is pointing out. That what maturity is when we get excited that our Father is getting glorified. When we get excited that people are turning from the temporal, from what they see around us, saying, God, you're doing this. And we get excited about his glory, about his fame, about thanksgiving going his direction. That's the motivation that Paul's looking for. That you would get jealous because there's thanksgiving out there that is rightfully due to God, and you give yourself to find it and point to the Father. I gotta be honest with you, like the times in my life where I've tasted this, it is such a fun way to live. You know, I've told this story before, but I learned this lesson as, you know, a high school athlete that grew up going to a really small school, and in that very small pond, I was an outstanding athlete, but then I got into a bigger pond and found out, oop, I am not such a great athlete. And I remember for the first time in my life being the guy that just barely made the team and now sitting on the bench. But what I found was, it was so fun when I realized, wow, those guys are fantastic soccer players. And I started like using my voice to cheer them on. I started celebrating their success, right? And I found a lot of freedom and a lot of joy in celebrating, right? In celebrating the greatness of other people. And God has designed us that way. God has designed us that we will find freedom not when we celebrate our greatness, or we live so that people would look to us, but when we live for people to look to him. Bernard of Clairvaux, who is he was a French abbot. He was a major leader in the Reformation of the Benedictine monasticism. So he's a monk. He lived between 1090 and 1153. His major contribution theologically was his work on what he calls the four degrees of love. This is very, this is powerful. So let's look at this. So the first degree of love is wherein man loves God for the sake of themselves, right? And so all of us entered into this kind of relationship with God, where we're like, God, you did this for me? Like, God, you care about me? God, you want to rescue me? And we love God for the sake of the benefits that come our direction, right? Do you get that, right? And that's not bad. I would just say that's immature, right? Where we love God because he does such wonderful things for us. That's natural, but that's the first degree of love. Then as we mature a little bit, man loves himself for God's sake. So then as we start to realize that God loves us, he values us, he treasures us, then we start to say, well, since God loves us, then I can, you know, then I can actually like honor who I am, right? And some of you have come to that point in your life where you've embraced the way that the way that God has designed you, you embrace that. So then the third degree is that man loves God for God's sake. Right, so now you're starting to think of, oh, this is about God, right? I think I messed this up. Yep, that second one is wrong. But man loves God for God's sake, right? So we love God for the sake of him, for the honor of him, right? So, and you do that in relationships as well, where you love people, you honor people, and you love them for their sake. You start to think about not yourself, you start to think about them. Well, the fourth degree of love is that man loves man for God's sake, right? Where we actually get in on the business of God and what is he most passionate about, right? And so we actually love each other for the sake of God. Where we love each other for the value or for the treasure of God being honored. So instead of just loving your spouse for what they offer to you, you love your spouse because it glorifies the Father, right? Or you serve your neighbor not simply because of what that does in your fame, your glory, or how it makes you feel, but you love them because it makes God look glorious. It makes God look beautiful. All right? So that is what Paul is tapping into, that we love, we serve, we engage because we want to honor the Father, because we want to make God look beautiful. All right, fourth, thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it demonstrates a proper understanding of the world. It demonstrates a proper understanding of the world. So in Ephesians 1:16, right, he says, I don't cease to give thanks. Romans 6:17, thanks be to God who's freed us, right? 1 Corinthians 15, thanks be to God who's given us victory, right? So all of these things, 2 Corinthians 2:14, thanks be to God who leads us in triumph. Right, so what happens is when we start to walk down a posture of gratitude and thanksgiving, we are seeing the world as it truly is. C.S. Lewis said it this way: gratitude exclaims very properly, how good of God to give me this. Right? So it moves from whatever this is and it gets to the giver of that gift and say, God is so good as he gave me that thing. And it helps us orient ourselves in the reality of what is around us. It trains us to see the world rightly, to see the world as it really is, a world where God is moving and orchestrating and giving and taking away. What we call, this is theologically what we call common grace. I'm going to borrow from Wayne Grudem a definition. Common grace is the grace of God by which he gives people innumerable, it's not easy to say, innumerable blessings that are not part of salvation. So common grace is different from saving grace in result, recipient, and source. So let me explain. Common grace is the blessing that God just gives all people, where he's pouring out good gifts. And he does this in the physical realm. Right? He gives you physical ability to do things. He gives you physical strength, right? So he gives you things physically, and we see that all over the New Testament. He gives you things in the intellectual realm. You have the capacity to think, to imagine, to dream. That is not an earned right. That is the grace of God, common grace that is on your life, that you have the capacity to use your intellect. God gives the common grace of morality and ethics, right? That there are things that are kind of born in us, that justice is something that we desire. Where does that come from? That's the common grace of God. God gives us the ability to be in relationship with other people, to have friends, to have family, to celebrate the gift of relationships. And then God also gives us the grace to comprehend him, to get to know what he is like. So you are surrounded. When you wake up every morning, you bump into the common grace of God. You can't get away from it, right? You sit here and you listen. You have comprehension. That's the common grace of God. That's not something that you've gotten by right or that you've earned. It is God being gracious to you. So thanksgiving rightly aligns us with the world around us. And you might say, yeah, but Greg, I'm a realist. I like to keep things real. So glass half empty, glass half full, right? I'm glass half empty person because I'm a realist. Well, if you're a realist, then there's also a glass that's half full, right? It's not just half empty, let's be real. So let's talk about what actually is. And what actually is that you live in a world surrounded by the common grace of God. You can't get away from it. The Father has been extravagant in his grace to you. Let's be real about that. And let's be thankful for the many things that the Father has done for you. So when we live a life of gratitude, we align ourselves rightly with a world that is filled with the glory and all of God. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is what? Full. It is filled with his glory. Open your eyes and say thank you. So thanksgiving is the theological positioning that says, God, you are the center. So I was here last night, and the singles group was just finishing up their event, and Allie King came up to me and said, I got to tell you a God story. And she just opened up and started telling me this story about, you know, one of the things that God did, and it was just so beautiful. She was so excited that she had seen God. And she took the time to basically say, thank you. And I'm not talking about adding, you know, hours and hours to your day. I'm talking about being intentional about what's going on around you. Just pause and, wow, God, you did that. Wow, God, you were showing up in that particular moment. Got to be honest, complaining is just a drag to be around. And I think the reason complaining is so frustrating to be around is because it doesn't see the world as it really is. Right? Isn't that what complaining does? Complaining takes the ugly parts, the broken parts, the hard parts, and then magnifies them as if they're the only part. Let's be real. Let's be honest. That's not all there is to the story. I'm not saying pretend that there's not hard things, pretend that there's not pain. No, be honest about those. But also, at the same time, be honest about the reality of God's favor that is extravagantly poured out on your life. So thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it demonstrates a proper understanding of the world. Fourth, thanksgiving is essential to maturity Thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it is the foundation of true worship. This is my favorite one. Thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it's that foundation of true worship. Listen to this verse, Romans 1:21. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. And here's what happened when they didn't give thanks. They became futile, right? Futile is broken, empty, vain, not accomplishing anything. They became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. So the first step away from God, according to Romans 1:21, was a refusal to honor God as God by saying thank you. By recognizing that all comes from him, by failing to see the world as it really is, a world that revolves around the ever-present glorious reality of God. When we fail to say thank you, we fail to align our hearts with worship. Our thanksgiving is the gatekeeper of worship. When we fail to acknowledge ingratitude, we fail to honor. And when we fail to honor God, right, we honor something that is now less than God, and the whole world is now turned upside down because what we were created for was worship. And so when we're not thanking God, we're not honoring him, and we're honoring something that is less than him. When you start to see the world as something that you're giving thanks to that's less than God, then you've put yourself in position to order the world, to organize it. You've earned it. You've made yourself the center of the universe. Without the discipline of thanksgiving in your life, where you recognize the majesty of God, your utter dependence on him for everything, without that disposition, you will turn every good thing that God has given you into a moment of idolatry. Because you fail to acknowledge him. We fail to honor him and give thanks to him. Because you will inevitably thank someone or something less than God for the goodness that he has offered you. And with that, your eyes will grow dim from seeing more of him, according to Romans 1:21. Next time you're in a place where you've recognized your failure. And let me be a little bit more biblical there. Next time you're in a place where you see sin, right? I don't wanna, make this so soft about failure. When you see that you've sinned, next time you lose your temper, next time you say a word in anger, next time you manipulate someone, right? Next time you see the fruit of sin in your life, what I want you to do is trace that back. When you see the negative evidence, right, of something off, trace it back. And what I think you're going to find at the root of that is a place where you didn't thank God for his provision. Because you didn't thank God for his provision, do you know what happened? Then you realize, uh-oh, God's holding out on me. I've got to secure something for myself. Then you start to strive, then you start to manipulate, then you start to lie because you found yourself on your own apart from God. And why are you on your own apart from God? Because you failed to see that God was providing everything that you need. You failed to trust him for it. You failed to wait on him. You failed to thank God for being God. So you took it upon yourself. And the inevitable root of that or the inevitable fruit of that is sin. So take the time, next time sin crops out of your life, it pops up, take the time to reflect and say, where did I go off track? And where you went off track, I guarantee, according to Romans 1:21, is you failed to honor God and give thanks to him. So thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it is the foundation of true worship. Without the discipline of thanksgiving in your life, you will slide down a pathway of idolatry. So this is what we've covered so far from Paul, right? This is what we've come to. Thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it's a command. It's essential to maturity because it helps us in our battle over the flesh, right? It's essential Thanksgiving is essential to maturity because it is the ultimate motivation for obedience, right? And it's also essential for maturity because it demonstrates a proper understanding of the world around us, and it's essential to maturity because it's that foundation of true worship. So you might be thinking, all right, Greg, I get it, right? Thanksgiving is essential. Like, how do I cultivate it? How do I grow in thanksgiving? How do I mature in this area of gratitude? Well, let me end with this. I think there's two things we have to do to grow in our thanksgiving. The first is we have to reject what I call the debtor's ethic, right? Often we are trapped in the sense of God does for us, so then we have to do for him. That we have to, it is our obligation to work and to do because what God has done for us. But what thanksgiving says is not, oh, God, you did something for me, now let me mow your lawn. Let me make sure I work in children's ministry. Let me help you out because you helped me out. That's the debtor's ethic. And all religious people deal with the debtor's ethic, right? Where I owe this great debt, I have to try and do my best to repay the debt that I've been given. This is the attitude of the older brother and the prodigal son, right? I earn my position with the father. This is a debtor's ethic. This is not God's design for us. So we have to reject the debtor's ethic. He doesn't want you to owe him. The father wants you to love him. I mean, think of like a gift that you would give to someone, where out of just love and your delight in them, you offer them this gift that is just a symbol of the treasure of them, and then they receive and like, thank you so much, that's very meaningful. How much do I owe you for that? Like, you've missed the point. God doesn't want us to owe him. God doesn't want you to earn good stars because he did things for you. He wants you to love him. So we have to work hard to reject the debtor's ethic. And then what we do is, instead of the debtor's ethic, we wrestle with exactly what the psalmist wrestles with here. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? So what do I do? If I'm rejecting the debtor's ethic, how do I respond to all the benefits of God? That's what Psalm 116:12 is asking. And look at the answer. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. So what do we do? When we recognize the benefits of God, we lift up the cup of salvation and we say, God, would you fill it again? God, would you give me more? We do exactly the way we honor a great Thanksgiving chef, as you say, more please. Or it's the way we honor a good novel. We say, more please, I need to keep reading that. Right? Or it's how we honor spending time with a close friend. It's not like, oh, I did that good, now I'll move on. We want more, right? The way that we honor God, the way that we honor him for the cup of salvation is we raise it up to him and say, God, that is so good. More, please. I raise the cup of salvation and I call on the name of the Lord. Let me go a little bit further. What is the cup that he's holding up? It's the cup of salvation. One of the ways that we can cultivate gratitude is that we get beyond common grace, right, and get into saving grace. Please hear this. It is the cup of salvation. A few minutes ago, I read Romans 6:17, but thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, right? So, thanks be to God for your salvation. You cannot save yourselves. One of the ways in which you cultivate gratitude is recognizing the fact that apart from God, you are utterly hopeless and deserving of death apart from the work of King Jesus. You are entirely apart from God until Jesus stepped in and said, I want to breathe life into them, and he paid your debt. And so the further we drift away from that core theological fact of what Jesus did on the cross, the more ingratitude we will find in our life. But the more centered we are on the great need that we have before God and the great extravagant love of Jesus on the cross, the more we will live a life of gratitude. So we reject the debtor's ethic and we raise the cup of salvation and we say, God, fill it again. I need more of you. Apart from you, God, I am hopeless. So the way that I want to close is in your bulletin. I've put some assessment questions. And I want you to, I want to give you some time to reflect on, like, how thankful are you? How much does gratitude or thanksgiving, right, reflect you? And how much are you living a pattern as a growing, mature follower of Jesus through the discipline, the spiritual discipline of thanksgiving? So there's a bunch of questions on there. My intent is not that you finish all those questions today, right? My intent is that you start just the process of asking yourself some of these questions. And even today, what I'd like you to do is plan a time to intentionally work through all seven of these questions. Because the contention that I lay before you today is that to be a mature follower of Jesus, we have got to grow in a pattern of thanksgiving. Let me pray for us. Jesus, I thank you for the Apostle Paul, and I thank you for his commitment to your church. I thank you for his love for your bride, and I thank you that you taught him, you explained to him the absolute necessity of thanksgiving for someone to be a mature follower of Jesus. And so I pray that just like the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Thessalonica, to the church in Colossae, to the church in Corinth, and he encouraged them to be people that are filled with thanksgiving, I pray that same prayer would be uttered over us, that Living Faith Alliance Church would be filled with a church of gratitude, a church of thanksgiving. And so I pray that even now, as people reflect on some of these questions, I pray your Holy Spirit would be at work. You would be convicting. You would be convincing. You would be doing what the Holy Spirit does to lead us into truth. So thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray, amen.
We're going to give you a couple minutes just to work on a couple of those questions. So take some time, and then we're going to see how we did at showing thanksgiving today. Invite you to stand with us and pause where you are in your answers and have a good assignment to take home with you, a good step to take. I had this thought the other day. We have a jar in our house that got started out of our pastor. It's called the Thankful Jar. So every once in a while, we go around the table and we write something we're thankful for and we share it and we put it in the jar. And then on Thanksgiving, we got that jar out and we read all the things that we had written over this last year. And so that's sort of where some of this idea comes from. So I asked you to do that this morning. So as we conclude a service that's on cultivating Thanksgiving in our hearts as a significant step for us in our transformation and in our spiritual life, I thought it'd be good for us to hear what we wrote. So we're gonna take turns. Ron and I are just gonna take turns reading these. So I invite you to take these words in, connect them to your life, let them stir more thanksgiving in you as we read these out. Feel free, if you need to close your eyes and listen to stay focused, you're welcome to do that. But you're certainly welcome. If you agree with some of these, you're certainly invited to say amen or some other appropriate response. So someone wrote out, God, I'm thankful for, so this is what we filled out, so go ahead and put that question up there. God, I'm thankful for redemption and forgiveness.
Mi Dios, estoy agradecida por clamar salvación por tu Hijo, Jesús Cristo.
For some people, you got that. It's beautiful. Second chances.
The air I breathe.
For the family I have in this shaky world.
Nature.
Thankful for my God.
God's grace.
For my family.
I am thankful for family.
Thankful for revelation.
Family.
We have a whole bunch of family.
That all things are used by God to show me his grace.
You saving me from my sin.
Hope.
Thankful for God's availability.
Friends.
Thankful for God's sovereignty.
Safety.
For food in my house.
Family.
For Emily.
Jesus.
Family.
Mommy.
Providential grace.
Loving suffering towards me.
Thankful for Jesus.
Mercy, goodness, and love.
Faith.
You.
Salvation.
Love.
Thankful for my second chance of being with my family.
Wow. Family, family. Family.
More family.
Food.
Faithfulness.
Jesus, my Savior, Sanctifier, Healer, and Coming King.
I'm thankful for my mom and dad.
My mommy.
Unconditional love.
You never leave me to figure out life alone.
Thankful for today.
Family.
The life you have blessed me with.
For God's grace.
Mercy.
God, I am thankful for your word.
Relentlessness.
For my family and wife who is steadfast. For my CR forever family.
Thankful for church.
Your love.
The love of God for us, for his healing.
Grace.
Any guesses? Family.
Jesus took care of every detail to provide salvation.
Somebody went origami on me. And guess what's inside? Family.
Family.
Jesus.
Stability.
Health.
Marriage.
That I'm not alone.
Love.
For God's provision. It's just what I need.
Family.
For his love for me.
Danny.
Redemption.
Your provisions.
For my friends.
My family.
For hope.
for your mercy, for your love, and for all that I have and don't have right now. I'm also thankful for the new life that is coming to this world.
Thankful for dance.
God, you are all.
Another chance.
Love.
Family.
My health.
Thankful for you.
Jesus.
For teaching me to live.
Perseverance.
My tumor is benign.
Forgiveness.
For grace.
Family.
For peace.
Thankful for this church still being here.
Thankful for you, God.
His faithful presence.
Thankful for life.
Love.
For your grace.
Family.
Thankful for life.
My family. 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 Family.
We're going to keep going. We're going to read them all, church. Sorry, I can't read that one.
Safety.
Oh, Ron, this is another Spanish one. I'll leave that to you.
La salvación de mi alma. En bendición de cantar.
For love. For Jesus. For health.
Grace.
Thankful for family.
Your presence.
God's provision.
Family.
God and health.